stand. Let's declare our praise to the living God.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name.
together, turn and say good morning to one another, cross the aisles, and would the kids come up for the children's sermon? This calendar, in preparing for the children's sermon today, this is the calendar I use to keep track of things, but there was also something that I kind of use a lot in life. Let me just get it. I love to read books. And so often, you know, I go around with me, I take books where I go. You can ask my family. I have a briefcase full of books because I'm always trying to read whenever I can. But you know, there's a new thing in my life that I try to carry so that if people need to get a hold of me and it's an emergency, and that's my cell phone, okay? Cell phones are good to have. I mean, well, you'll learn about it later. Oh, technology. But sometimes, you know, when I'm resting, I love to play the guitar. So I've got my guitar right there. Actually, this is like a symbol of my guitar. It's a stuffed guitar. Okay. And then, when I'm not working or using my cell phone or playing guitar, I love to just hang out and have fun with my friends. Well, I have more fun than that. But, and then, I also, besides reading and using the phone and having fun and playing guitar, I really like to eat. Do you guys like to eat? Isn't eating cool? Aren't you glad God made taste buds? These are donuts. And I don't know how old they are, but they're donuts. And so, a lot of times in life, I love to read, and I plan my calendar, and I use the phone, and I love to have fun, and I love to eat and play guitar. But you know what happens sometimes? For real, I'm not kidding around. Sometimes in my life, I get so busy doing all these things that my arms aren't freed up to give God a hug or just to spend time with God. So sometimes in life, Pastor Ken's going to talk about this today. Sometimes in life, you don't eat. And you maybe, it's called fasting. You'll learn about it later. But you sort of take time out from eating just to focus a little bit. And then you just take time out from just laughing and having fun all the time. And you turn off the phone or you don't answer it. And you just say, you know, I'm not going to do homework for a minute, or I'm not going to read just for now. I'm just going to be kind of quiet. I'm going to put the calendar away. Yeah. You put the guitar away. And it's really good in your life, like on a Thursday or a Monday or on a Sunday, where you have a little moment of time. You have a little moment of time where you're not really busy doing anything. And you're kind of quiet, and you have some time just to say to God, God, I love you. And you know what the Bible says? The Bible wants us to know that beyond all the things in our life, even food, the most important thing we really need is God, only God. I hope you boys and girls really hear that. It's really important. I'm going to say it again. Beyond all the things, toys, clothes, food, telephones, books, the one thing we really need is God, only God. So I hope you guys remember that, and I hope you never get too busy or full of things that kind of distract you from showing God your love. So let's be real quiet. Let's have some moments of just quietness. Be real still. Put your hands down. And let's just have some moments of quiet, and then I'll lead us in a prayer, okay? Let's pray. help us sometimes to turn off the TV or to just sit in a chair and just to think about you. Remind us, God, today and every day that you're all that we need. Thank you so much for life and for showing us your love. Because, Jesus, it's in your name that we pray. Amen. Nobody's going to help me up?
No.
Pull! Pull! Ah! Let's praise.
We pray for our nation. We pray for our world. For Lord, they struggle too. The nations struggle. The nations look for hope in some place. And we pray that you would be sending people to give them hope. We pray for missionaries. We pray for those whose commission is to bring your peace. We pray for nations who are struggling even now in the midst of elections, especially we think of Iraq, for places where it is dangerous to share opinion or a choice. Lord, we pray ultimately that you would be working all things together that all might choose you. Lord, we pray all these things in the strong and holy name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Show your mercy and your grace. Come and fill us, Lord.
given us, Lord, but even those spiritual gifts and those gifts that have given us the experiences and the passion, Lord, to live as your disciples. May the offering that we give now, Lord, may it be a returning of the blessing that you have given us. Lord, if we could roll up into a ball and jump into the offering plate ourselves, we would. Let these gifts that we give support this church. May it represent, Lord, our total life commitment to you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Beautiful, anyone, ever, every day, you're the same, you never change, never. You are more beautiful than anyone, ever, every day, you're the same. Never change, no, never. How could I ever deny the love of my Savior? You are to me all I need, all I need, ever, ever. How could you be so good? There is no one like you. There has never, ever been anyone like you. You're so astounding. How could you be so good to me? Eternally, I believe there is no one like you. There has never, ever been anyone like you. There is no one like you. There has never, ever been anyone like you. 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 How could you be so good to me? How could you be so good to me?
Reflective tune. That was just wonderful. Thank you so much. Okay, let's pray. Lord, there is no one like you. Ever has, is, or will be. And you are the God who has chosen to have a relationship with us and to bring us into a relationship with you. It's just unimaginable. And so, Lord, we pray that as we sing praises to you and as we confess our sin, as we get through this life, and as we try to please you and worship you, as we see your word and hear it, Lord, that you will use all these things to transform our lives so that we may look like you. In Jesus' name, amen. Did you know that it is unlawful to plow a cotton field in North Carolina using an elephant? These are true. Did you know that lawn darts are illegal in Canada? Did you know that it is the law that every citizen in the state of Kentucky must take a bath at least once a year? It's a good law. Did you know that it is against the law to hunt whales in Oklahoma? Just in case one comes up 4,000 miles up the coast there, you see a whale in Oklahoma, you can't hunt it. Did you know that in Saudi Arabia, a wife is allowed to divorce her husband if he does not keep her well supplied with coffee? Thinking of an amendment to the Constitution of the United States, women? For the last several weeks, we have been looking at, under the very competent and skillful leadership of our senior pastor, Andrew Ross, training from the inside out. And basically, Andy's been talking to us about spiritual disciplines. And I mention these laws to you not because in some way they make us laugh and chuckle, and not that all laws enslave us, because there are some laws that actually free us to enjoy the freedoms we have. But as we enter into these spiritual disciplines and as we think about training from the inside out, we need to make sure that we don't get legalized by them. And these spiritual disciplines are nothing new. They're found in the Old Testament. You can go way back in the Old Testament. You can find them throughout the New Testament into the early church, into the church of the 14th and 15th centuries and those middle centuries. And even today, these spiritual disciplines, some of that Andy has been talking about, are practiced today. Now, I'd like to make a brief comment on how, once again, it seems that I am the recipient of a scripture or a topic which is a little abnormal. This seems to be a pattern in my life here as the associate pastor at your Northminster Presbyterian Church. The Reverend Ross has led us through what I would call wonderful and what I would term common or maybe not so ordinary spiritual disciplines. Dr. Ross, he likes me to call him that now that Pete's arrived. Began encouraging us to pay attention to our spiritual, our inner life, as well as our physical or our outer life. A noble and biblical goal. Next, he pontificated about how important it is for us to read the scripture on a daily basis. In fact, he even talked to us a little bit about how we might even read scripture in a different way. Very insightful and interesting, and it's helped me in a very serious way as he's talked about that. He's even given us a little bit of a help. You can go to the back and pick up some pages, a booklet that will help you read through the Bible, which most of us have, in a 3-year period. Then came prayer. Most of you probably didn't find that abnormal or surprising.
Last week was worship, both individual and corporate. And well, look, here you all are. Just like your senior pastor told you to. Now comes my week. The discipline that I'm handed to convince you that this might be a good idea to try in your life on a regular basis. I asked myself, would it be the discipline of rest, or quiet, or singing, or enjoying nature? No. No. I get fasting. 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 You know, I can hardly wait till the next series. Let's say on spiritual gifts. Is there any doubt I will get the spiritual gift to preach on of exorcism? There's no doubt. He's making notes right now. So I picked a couple of scriptures we're going to read and refer to. The first one's from Deuteronomy 8, 1-4. Be careful to follow every command I am giving you today, so that you may live and increase and may enter and possess the land that the Lord promised on oath to your forefathers. Remember how the Lord your God led you all the way in the desert these 40 years to humble you and to test you in order to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commands. He humbled you, causing you to hunger and then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your fathers had known, to teach you that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Your clothes did not wear out. Your feet did not swell during these 40 years. The next one's from Mark. Now John's disciples and the Pharisees were fasting. John the Baptist. These are John the Baptist's disciples. Some people came and asked Jesus, how is it that John's disciples and the disciples of the Pharisees are fasting, but yours are not? Jesus answered, how can the guests of the bridegroom fast while he is with them? They cannot, so long as they have him with them. But the time will come when the bridegroom will be taken from them, and on that day, they will fast. Thanks, Chris. Before I start talking about fasting specifically, I think I'd like to challenge you just to think a little bit with me as we think about this whole training from the inside out and these spiritual disciplines that Andy and I and Pete will be talking about and have talked about. I think it's important for us to understand the motive of why we want to practice these spiritual disciplines in our lives as Christians. Because I believe if we have the wrong motive behind these disciplines, we will soon understand that they will become legalistic to us. And that in the very sense, instead of freeing us, they will enslave us. Instead of allowing us to know and love God more, they can put in some sense a little bit of sense of bitterness in our heart. And that's why we have to have, I think, our motives right. And most of these observations, I have to tell you, come forth out of my years in youth ministry and the observations that at times I have applied and I see many other youth ministers apply to youth ministry. One of the greatest temptations when you do youth ministry is the idea of pragmatism. What works? Because when you've got 35 middle school kids running around, chasing after their hormones, your question is, what works? You know, how do I get a handle on this? How do I get control of this? And I think in general, for many evangelical Protestant churches in America, we've sort of bowed to that pragmatic way of thinking also. But it's very subtle, and you have to watch it. Because that's exactly what Satan wants us to believe. He kind of wants us to believe that sort of normality in our Christian life is just fine, and everything is hunky-dory. Because you see, when we look at Christianity or as our faith as something that is pragmatic, this is what happens. What happens is truth becomes what works. And what works, since it works, becomes good. Or at least not all that bad. And so this is what we do. What we start to do is we start to apply that to Jesus. We follow Jesus because he works. Jesus becomes something that you can now see and believe in because it works, at least better than all the options we have out of there. He kind of becomes like the ultimate soft drink. You get all of the flavor with none of the calories and the caffeine and all that other stuff that's in there that's bad for you. But here's the problem. The problem is, what happens when it seems that Jesus doesn't work? You know, in youth ministry, and I fall into this trap all the time. Sometimes I get thinking, I've just got to convince the kids that Jesus is beneficial for their life. If I can get them to understand that if they follow Jesus, you know, things are going to go a little better for them, then hey, they'll accept him. They'll get involved in the church. Maybe they'll become an elder or a deacon. They'll start to tithe. And on and on and on and on. But the problem is, what happens when it seems that Jesus doesn't work? What happens when it seems like Jesus isn't there? What happens when it seems like God isn't in control? What happens when it seems that things in our life start to happen and we think, oops, it's the devil 8 and God 2. What happens when a family gets a phone call, a Christian family, who go to church, who are elders, who are Sunday school teachers, who love Jesus, and they find out their son or daughter has been killed by a drunk driver? What happens when it seems that Jesus doesn't work? C.S. Lewis once said that if you want a comfortable faith, I certainly don't recommend Christianity. Now, what does all this have to do with spiritual disciplines, and especially the discipline of fasting? Well, I would submit to you that if you take up the challenges that Andy has given, or that I give you this morning, or some of the challenges that Pete will continue to give you, and as we continue to look at spiritual disciplines throughout the year in our congregation, I hope that you will not do them in a pragmatic way. In other words, somehow, if you do this, I'll get this. Because you will fail. Oh, you may pick up the booklet and you may get through the Bible in 3 years. You know, you may make worship more of a priority in your life. You may pray a little bit more in the day. But in some ways, you'll start to resent it because you feel like you have to, because that's what will work. And the goal of spiritual disciplines is that we know and love God more. Now, fasting. I have to tell you, I'm not a faster. I think I tried for like a month, one day a week, and it did not go well. I failed. I was undisciplined. I just didn't carry through on it. And I tell you that just to be honest, so you're not looking at me as if you would, but just in case there's some of you here who were thinking, oh, Ken can talk about fasting because he's actually experienced it. Well, I've experienced it a little bit, but very, very little. So let me make some points about fasting, and at this point, in some ways, the sermon may turn into a little bit more of a class. But I thought it was important that we talk about fasting and just flesh out some things that it is and it isn't. And I think we've got some points there. The first one is, biblically, fasting and prayer always go together. You always find that in the Bible, where if you find either a group of people or a person fasting, they're always, always in prayer. Or prayer is associated at some point with that fasting. The second one is, the goal of any spiritual discipline, including fasting, is freedom. In other words, whatever spiritual discipline you may want to incorporate in your life, the idea is that it will free you up. Free you up from either time or material things that you have, or free you up from some kind of thought process that you might have. But the goal is freedom. Third, fasting is not an end in itself. It is a means to an end in which we can become more attentive to God. See, and in many ways, we may say, gee, that's kind of impractical. Being attentive to God. I don't know if I have time being attentive to God. I've got things to do. My cell phone's ringing. I've got a business deal. I've got to get the kids to soccer. But that is the goal. And fasting, like any other spiritual discipline, is just a means to that goal. Okay, next. Fasting does not make you more spiritual than Christians who do not fast. And that's an important one. And we see that in the New Testament. We see where that attitude gets us, don't we? In 1st and 2nd Corinthians, a church that is just a complete mess. I mean, it's completely dysfunctional. And Paul has to come in, and the gift, or what's going on there, is not fasting, it's speaking in tongues. There's a whole bunch of people speaking in tongues, and there's people that are not speaking in tongues, and the people that are speaking in tongues are looking down on those that aren't. That somehow they're more spiritual. And so please, as a church or individuals, we need to make sure that, you know, because, you know, you're a great prayer and somebody doesn't spend as much time in prayer, somehow you're more spiritual than they are. You know, or, you know, well, I've been fasting for like a year now, and how come you're not fasting? And we it's very easy for us to get in those one-upmanship kinds of things. And so we need to remember, again, that in many ways this is a discipline to give us freedom and to make us attentive to God. It's not some kind of hierarchy of who we are as Christians. Okay. Fifth one is, fasting does not only have to be associated with food. It can include TV, entertainment, speaking, technology, work, or busyness, or even business. You can fast from all these things. You can choose to say, one day a week, I'm not going to watch any TV. Or one day a week, I'm trying not to do anything technological. I'm going to shut my computer. I'm not going to be on the cell phone. I guess if you have a car, that's kind of technology, so you have to drive to get around. Maybe you'll just stay home. But whatever it is, maybe you'll have a fast from speaking and you'll just try to be silent for one day. It doesn't need to involve food, even though that's probably the most common type that we look at. As far as I can tell, there's only two very extreme types of fasting in Scripture. One is from Moses and Jesus, where they both fast without food and water for 40 days. And I tell you about those things because you should never try that. I mean, that is in the context, a specific context, and there is so much supernatural intervention into Moses and Jesus that somehow to carry those over and say, oh, we should be able to do that, I think is very, 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 very dangerous. You will not get sick. You will not pass out. You will die. And don't let anybody tell you, ever, that somehow, well, Jesus fasted for 40 days with no food or water, so certainly you can. Nah, last time I checked, I'm not Jesus. I'm not the Son of God. Neither are you. So we need to be very, very careful. Let me make a few other comments about fasting. Usually, when we talk about fasting, it's not just about stopping or abstaining from something. It's also in the context of adding something else. And so I would encourage you, if you were to take up this spiritual discipline for a season, that you, while that time that you're fasting from something, add something else. Add another spiritual discipline. Maybe it's journaling, or maybe it's reading some scripture, or maybe it's a prayer time. But add something to it. So it's not just something doing without, you also add something to your life. Remember that the idea when you fast is to draw closer to God. Okay, three primary kinds of fasting. Normal fast. This is going without food for a definite period of time. And maybe, you know, one day a week. It could be a half a day. It is never going without food, from my perspective, from food and or water or juice. I think you should always drink some water or juice, especially if you're fasting for a day or more. You need to always, and please, if there's some health concerns here, then you need to check with your doctor. I'm trying to be very wise about this. And then you should be wise about this. Okay, the second one is a partial fast. One omits certain foods or one meal each day for a number of consecutive days. In other words, you won't drink milk for 4 days in a row. Or you won't have meat for 3 days in a row. And so it's not what you would call, it's not like that normal fast where you're just one day and you're not going to eat any food except water or juice, but you just omit certain foods, or one meal a day. You're not going to have lunch, or you won't have dinner, you know, on Monday and Fridays for a month. Okay, the third one is a rotational fast. One omits certain groups of foods for designated period of times. And that can be anything. So groups of food, grains. You know, you decide that every Wednesday for 6 weeks, you're not going to eat some kind of grain or whatever that is. When we talk about fasting, we really are talking about the discipline of abstinence. And abstaining from anything doesn't really play well in our culture. But it's essential, I think, for us to understand that what spiritual disciplines at their very core challenge us to do is to tangibly experience what it means to abstain from something that we are either attached to or attracted to. And fasting, maybe more than any of the other disciplines we have looked at, brings us face to face with how easy it is to put the material world above He who created it and sustains it. Food is necessary for life, but it is not more important than God. Work is important to life, but it's not more important to God. Entertainment is important to life, but it's not more important to God than God. Physical pleasure is important in life, but it's not more important than God. And we live in a culture whose message is completely opposite. We live in a culture that preaches more and bigger is better. Why live a normal life when you can supersize it? And we live in a culture that says whatever you do, never, ever, ever, ever deny yourself something that you feel is natural or pleasing to you. That's our culture. That's its message. Denial is not part of the message. And yet Jesus gives us something completely different. Jesus gives us an example of a complete opposite message. In fact, if we looked at Jesus' life, we can see that almost all of Jesus' life is in some ways a life of fasting or abstinence. Whether it was abstaining from the temptation of turning rocks into bread, or whether it was the temptation to somehow show how powerful he was and how big he was and how he could do all these signs, or whether it was abstaining from trying to convince God, his Father, in that garden that there was an alternative way to the cross, we see that Jesus' life is a disciplined life of putting God first and his will, and Jesus' will second. And in many ways, that is what our series has and will continue to be about. Once again, as we enter into the season of Lent, as we prepare for our spiritual growth series that starts next Sunday, we are reminded that there is a cost to following Jesus. And part of that cost for you may be to choose to start a habit of a spiritual discipline that we have looked at. And I would suggest that you seriously pray and start considering what that habit might be. And maybe it'll be the discipline of fasting. But maybe it won't. And that's okay. Next week, Pete is going to have a sheet in our bulletin that is going to give you a little bit of a guide if you want to choose fasting as a spiritual discipline during this Lenten season and beyond. And so I hope that you look for that, and he might say a few things about it next week. And you know the suggestions that Andy has already given you and the tools that are here in the church to help you with other spiritual disciplines. But let me give you one final footnote, and we shouldn't miss this as we talk about spiritual disciplines, whether it's fasting or others. And that is that spiritual disciplines may start with our own individual time with God, but it should never stop there. In fact, the goal of spiritual disciplines is first and foremost to move us closer to God and be attentive to his will, but then to move us out into our world and be a change agent for it. You see, the more we're attentive to God, then the more we're attentive to his will. And the more we're attentive to his will, the more we'll be attentive to his world. And the more we're attentive to the world, the more we'll be attentive to its hurts and its longings and its needs. And the more we're attentive to that, the more we'll be empowered to show Christ's light and forgiveness and salvation to a world that desperately needs that. Let's pray. Lord, we come before you and we thank you so much. Lord, we thank you that you call us to some disciplines in our lives. But they are disciplines, Lord, that are meant to free us. To free us so we can be more attentive and know and love you more. And then be a vessel of change for you to our world. Father, help us to take some time to consider and pray what you would have us do as we enter into this season of Lent and even beyond. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand. Let's sing.
Show me.
disciplined in reading the bulletin. May God bless you and keep you. May you know his grace and his face that shines upon you. May you know his giving. And may you know his taking away. And may you know his discipline in your life. And as you practice those, may you be attentive and love him more. In Jesus' name, amen.